The day of the Feast of St. Vincent, the Fathers, and the Day of the Feast of St. Peter Celestine, the Pope, who abdicated about 700 years ago, here again in Kingman, Arizona, with a few considerations. So, that St. Peter Celestine, he was the Pope in the time where there's the longest distance that we've ever had in the last 2,000 years between the papacies. It was 2.5 years. 2.5 years. One of the arguments of the state of Vicondas is that we've had interims without popes before. And in fact, over the last 2,000 years, since St. Peter died in the year 64 AD, all the way until today, the longest period we've ever had without a pope was before St. Peter Celestine was elected pope. And that was 2.5 years. And St. Peter Celestine said he was a monk. He wasn't even a priest. He was a hermit and a monk living in the mountains in a hermitage in Italy. And the cardinals gathered together to elect a pope, but there were so many bad popes, one bad pope after another. And they didn't want there to be yet another bad pope. And so they argued and argued, and then they debated and debated. And the year went by, and then 2 years went by, and then more than 2 years went by, and there was still no pope. And St. Peter Celestine, in his St. Peter the Hermit, wrote from his hermitage and said, "The church needs a father. We can't have our church without our father. Our Lord said, without thou art Peter, this upon this rock I will build my church. And we need the rock. We need Peter. Therefore, you must elect a pope before you yourselves are condemned by God." And they wanted to elect a holy pope. And all the cardinals were pretty much bad. And in most of those days, it wasn't heresy that was the problem, but rather immorality. Though there was also some errors and heresy, Albigensian heresy. There were heresies floating around at that time. And some of the bishops had been infected with them, but they were just tired of having bad popes. So they wanted to elect a good pope, and then St. Peter wrote a letter, "You must elect a good pope soon, and if you don't, you'll be condemned by God." So the cardinals left the conclave. They went straight to the cave of St. Peter the Hermit. They dragged him out of the cave, and they brought him to Rome and said, "You're the pope. We want to have a holy pope." And so they knew he was holy, and so they made him pope. So he had to be ordained very quickly. He was ordained a subdeacon, deacon, priest, then consecrated a bishop. And the moment that he became bishop, he became the head of the Holy Roman Catholic Church and the Bishop of Rome. He didn't even know how to celebrate Mass. But he was made pope, and he had to learn slowly how to celebrate Mass. But once he became Bishop of Rome, he became the Holy Father. And he became the head of the Holy Roman Catholic Church. But he was so very humble, but also very charitable, and he had no brains of any kind. He was not educated at all. He was very holy, but he was very gentle and very kind. And when St. Peter became the pope, he became the holy pope, one of the holy popes, the holiest popes we've ever had. But he didn't know anything about ruling. He didn't know anything about papacy. He didn't know anything about being a bishop. He didn't know anything about being a priest. But he was a valid priest, and he was a valid bishop. And he was the Bishop of Rome, didn't know how to celebrate Mass, but couldn't do the pontifical ceremonies, but he was the Bishop of Rome, and he was a saint. He was very holy. But what happened during his brief reign? The church almost completely collapsed. Because when St. Peter the Hermit became pope and called himself Pope Celestine, and so he is St. Peter Celestine, Celestine the First or Celestine the Second, when St. Peter Celestine was called Pope Celestine, you know, that he became a very holy pope, but the Dominicans would come in. Dominicans hate Franciscans, and Franciscans hate Dominicans, and the Benedictines hate it, and each group hates the other group, have all kinds of agendas. And they all came into the pope and said, "Pope, I think you should, St. Peter, you should excommunicate the Franciscans. It's really bad." Okay, so he'd excommunicate them. And the Franciscans come in and say, "No, you shouldn't do that. It's the Dominicans are really bad." "Oh, I didn't know that." So then he'd excommunicate the Dominicans. And then he would make a rule and another rule because he believed what everyone was telling him. And he was not able to be pope. But he was a valid bishop and a valid priest. And he was ordained and he became pope. And that, so that we see that it's not sufficient to be just validly ordained. It's not sufficient to just be priest or just be bishop. Saint Teresa of Avila said, "In finding a spiritual director,
She found priests that were very holy, a few priests who were very, very holy, but they were not knowledgeable in their theology. They didn't know their faith well. They didn't know their theology well enough. And hence, they gave all kinds of bad advice. It's like a priest, remember, is like a doctor. And a doctor is someone who is not just healthy or who wants people to be healthy, but a doctor is one who knows that the heart is different from the liver and that the heart and liver are different from the legs, and that the legs have one function and arms have another function, and that certain foods are good to produce certain effects and certain foods are harmful to your health. And the doctor needs to know these things, so that if he's just a doctor who is a very holy doctor, and if he's just a doctor who wants everyone to be healthy, and he's just a doctor who believes what he's told because he thinks people are innocent and honest, then when you go to that doctor, you've got a pretty good chance of dying. And this is what happened to the Holy Roman Catholic Church during the brief reign of St. Peter Celestine. His reign was so terrible that only 30 years later, or less than 20 years, 30 years later, shortly afterwards, and then only 10, 15 years later, Dante, when he wrote the Inferno, he put people who he thought did bad in hell. He put St. Peter Celestine in hell. He says maybe he was a very holy monk, and he was. But he was a very bad pope, therefore he's in hell. And so St. Peter Celestine was placed in hell in the Inferno of Dante, the most beautiful poem ever written. And Dante put St. Peter Celestine in hell because he was not a good pope. And he wasn't a good pope. He was a very holy monk. He was a very holy deacon. He was a very holy priest. He was a very holy bishop, a very holy bishop of Rome. But he didn't know anything about deacon, priest, bishop. He didn't know anything about doing his duty in this world. And what has made St. Peter Celestine such a great saint is that when he was made pope, there was no more wonderful, more prestigious position on the planet Earth. Remember, the whole of Europe is Catholic. And everyone loves and honors and respects the pope. He has the greatest dignity, the greatest honor, the greatest respect, and the greatest gifts the world can give. Even though he's the head of the Holy Roman Church, he's also was the most respected man on earth. And St. Peter Celestine said, I like being a monk. I like praying. I like fasting. But I don't even know how to celebrate Mass. I have a hard time with the Latin. I don't know what ceremonies to do. I don't know even how to be a pope. And they made me a bishop, and they put this pointed hat on my head, and then they put this tiara on me, and I'm the ruler of the world, but I don't understand what it means to rule, and therefore, I am going to resign, and you must make another man pope. I don't need the tiara. I don't need the trappings of the papacy. I don't need the pleasure and the adulation of the world. I'm just not good at this. Not able to make decisions, not able to rule, not able to guide. God didn't give me these gifts. And therefore, he resigned. St. Peter Celestine was the only pope that actually resigned because it was the will of God and to show his sanctity. And he didn't care about the trappings of papacy and the honor of the world. And he went back to be a hermit, and he died a hermit. And after him was made a good pope, but he was not a saint. Boniface VIII was a very strong pope. Boniface VIII became pope in a very corrupt time. And the world was changing from Middle Ages of glory to our age of horror and death and decay. And Boniface VIII was that pope in the great transition period. St. Peter Celestine, the last pope of the holy period of the church. Boniface VIII, the first pope of the decline of the church. But he was a very good pope, but he was not a saint. He wasn't wicked, but he was not a saint. And Pope Boniface VIII stood for the rights of the church. And meanwhile, because of Peter Celestine, the Lagists, who would later become ruled by the Jews and the money began to enter into the church. Money began to rule. For the very first time in the history of the world, money began to rule. And Boniface VIII stood up against them. And they felt that the papacy had lost so much respect that they took Boniface VIII and they threw him down and they beat him up inside while he was wearing his sacred vestments. Papacy was losing its respect. But St. Peter Celestine was a very holy man and a great saint, but he was not a great pope. One thing that is required in order to be continuing the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ from one generation to the next, God chose that he would use human instruments. And the human instruments must have certain minimum requirements. And St. Peter Celestine shows the holiness and the incredible gift, virtue of humility. He is a great saint of humility because he offered up all the trappings that the church has to give in order to be a humble monk, and he died a humble monk. But as Pope, he was a disaster. And so in our present situation, we need, the church needs not only holy bishops and holy priests. There are many good priests right now in the Novus Ordo. Priests who are trying to be holy, who want to be good, but they don't understand that the new mass is intrinsically evil and not just an abuse. And they want to be holy and good. They tell people to say the perpetual help devotions. They tell people to do their rosaries. And they do fasting and they do penance more than we do. And they have a supernatural life. But they don't understand that Vatican II is intrinsically evil, intrinsically offensive to God, and that it must be condemned and abandoned completely. It is not enough to say, I'm going to be spiritual and holy in order to save the church. What is necessary is to condemn the evil and errors and heresies that are in the world today. They must be condemned. The evil, the errors, and the heresies must be condemned. And so that, and then the truth must be taught. When we go to the Holy Father, we ask him, what is the right teaching of the apostles? Because some men say this and other men say that. What does it really mean when we say that Jesus Christ is true God and true man? The Arians say that he's very God-like, but he's not God. He's very God-like. What does that mean? Is he very God-like or is he God? And the Father, Holy Father stands up and says, it is a teaching of the holy apostles. It is a teaching of Jesus Christ himself that he is true God, true and complete God and true man. He is real man and he is real God. It's not enough to say, be spiritual and holy, but we must believe that he is truly God and that he is truly man. And the same is true of all the teachings of our holy church. And St. Peter Celestine believed in all the teachings, but he was not able to implement, to enforce them. He was not able to explain them. He was not able to show to souls, this is what Jesus Christ teaches. This is what you must believe to be a true follower of Christ. Therefore, he resigned. We must pray that in the church today, that there be holy priests, priests that love God, priests that want to turn away from sin and want to be spiritual. But they must understand that the priesthood is a doctor. And the doctor must teach. The word doctor means to teach. The doctor must teach the truth and not error. He must teach good and not evil. And so even if the doctor is very well-meaning, when he tells people, take cyanide, make sure you go to the new mass with devotion. Go to the new mass where the priest wears, holds his thumb and finger together. No, that new mass is evil. The new mass is evil. Whether the priest is good or not, the new mass is evil. It must be condemned. It cannot go to it. The same is true of the indult mass. There are many spiritual priests and good people who are very holy who go to the indult mass, who go to the approved masses that are Latin masses, but they're not holding the doctrine as it was handed down by our ancestors. They're not holding the truth as it was handed down. Therefore, there's harm rather than good coming from that mass. Even though the people that are there are very good, we must not only be spiritual and holy, but we have to stand for the truth and condemn the errors and the lies in order to persevere in our holy faith from one generation to the next. Let us pray, therefore, not only for holy priests, but priests who are holy priests who believe firmly the doctrine of the apostles as it was handed down, and who will give the gift of being able to explain it and teach it to souls. And in this way, we pass the faith from one generation to the next. Those who have us all, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.